Hushed. Hello, everybody. My name's Corey Roskin. I work for the City of West Hollywood in social services, and I also help put on some different events for the city that are related to literary programming. We are really excited about the event tonight. The city has been hosting a number of different literary programs over the last few years as part of what we're calling our WeHo Reads program. And in addition, about a year ago, one of our council members initiated what we're calling the Lesbian Speaker Series. And we've had some incredible events that have been, a number of them are literary. We've had some film events. We've had some other things. So tonight's program is sponsored by the City of West Hollywood, both the WeHo Reads program and the Lesbian Speaker Series program, and the West Hollywood Library. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in just a moment, but I want to bring up John Duran, who's going to talk a little bit about the Lesbian Speaker Series. John, are you? Oh, there you are.
Thank you, Corey. My name is Councilmember John Duran from the City of West Hollywood. And if you've heard me give this little spiel before, please forgive me. I'm about to repeat myself of what I say each time. But it's important that this be said. The reason that this series was created was it's one small way for gay men here in the city of West Hollywood and throughout greater Los Angeles to say thank you to our lesbian sisters. During the HIV and AIDS epidemic, when we were at our darkest hours, it was lesbian women who stepped up to the plate. Even though we didn't have deeply connected relationships in the early 80s, we were just starting to get to know each other. The reality is that lesbian women heard the call, they came to our assistance, they formed organizations with us, they led the battle, and as we were losing brothers left and right, it was lesbian women that continued to lead the charge in the fight against HIV and AIDS. So, this is just a small token of thank you to our lesbian sisters for everything you did for us in the 80s and 90s and continue to do for us. We will continue, Corey will tell you more about additional speaker series that we're having in the future, but I also wanted to highlight that another thing that we're doing is the Worley Building, which is just around the corner here. We have established a permanent home for the June Mazur Archives to have lesbian herstory forever preserved here in the city of West Hollywood. So if you are one of these, if you are one of these lesbian hoarders that has lots of documents and materials and campaign buttons and posters and pictures and things in your garage that you just, you know, you've been carrying around and moving around for decades, not really knowing where they were going to live eventually. You know, the June Mazur Archives are interested in looking at what you have, and if you think it's historical and can be of great use to tell future generations about, you know, lesbian culture and lesbian stories here in Southern California and across the nation, they're interested in your stuff. All right, so we will hopefully be having the great ribbon cutting next year for the June Mazur Archives permanently sited at the Worley Building around the corner. But if you've got stuff, well, I'm sure the June Mazur Archives would love to talk to you about what you have. All right, so with that, I'll turn it back over to Corey to open our program, and thank you all for coming this evening.
So thanks to Councilmember John Duran, and also to the rest of our council, Mayor Lauren Meister, Mayor Pro Tempore John Heilman, and council members John D'Amico and John Heilman. Also want to thank my colleagues in social services, David Juni, Corey Plank, usually Corey, that's the other Corey, is here with me, but she couldn't be here tonight. And my colleague Leslie Eisenberg, who's sitting out there checking folks in. And she's sitting out there with Jeffrey Sichelnois, and he is the manager of the West Hollywood Library, and they've been a great collaborator on these events as well. And then just finally, in terms of our WeHo Reads program, our cultural affairs staff, Andrew Campbell and Michael Che, and they both couldn't be here tonight either, but they're instrumental in so many different things that happen in the city that are cultural arts related, whether they're literary, film, dance, music, et cetera. I just want to mention really quickly, John was talking about the Lesbian Speaker Series. We have an incredible event coming up July 13th, and there's some flyers out there. Eileen Miles, who just was chosen the 2016 Lambda Literary Pioneer at their event in New York about a month ago, she's going to be here, incredible writer, legendary. and poet and art critic. She's going to be here with Rebecca Walker, who's also a pretty incredible writer. And it'll be here again on July 13th. It's again, it's sponsored by the city. It's free to come here. We validate the parking. We hope you'll consider buying books. You don't have to, but we'd love to see you here for that event. So the flyer's out there, my info's on there. Let me know if you're gonna come. It should be a great event. Okay, so, really quick details. Probably you already know bathrooms are out that way. Book Soup has books that you can purchase, and if you want them signed afterwards, Natalie will sign them, and we'll have a little bit of a reception as well afterwards. And also there's a parking validation machine out there, which the folks out in front can show you if you didn't validate your parking. All right, so I know you want to get on with the event and not hear from me too much. So I'm going to introduce our moderator for the evening, Stephen Raines. For those of you who don't know Stephen Raines, he's pretty incredible. He's the first city poet of the city of West Hollywood, and he, yeah, you have to clap. And he has done unbelievable programming. I mean, I was on the committee that helped select, and we knew he'd be good, but we just had no idea the amount of creative energy he would put into the program over the last couple years. And Stephen was really, even though I helped with this, he was instrumental in making this happen tonight with Natalie Goldberg. He's a poet, he's an educator, he's our city poet, he has over a dozen chapbooks, he's published two poetry collections. The recent one, Inheritance, is for sale. Okay, this says in the back of the room, so
it's that way.
That back, out there. He's got a BA in creative writing, a master's in clinical psychology, and he's a 10-time recipient of the LA City Department of Cultural Affairs Artist in Residency Grant Program. He's taught many writing workshops around the country for over 15 years with LGBT youth, people living with HIV. He's worked with LGBT seniors doing poetry writing groups. Yeah, it's pretty amazing. And I've been in some of his workshops. He's pretty incredible. Okay, it says if you're interested in taking one of his workshops in the future, you can sign up for his mailing list in the back of the room. Okay, it's that back of the room. It's over there, out at the table. And you can check him out at stephenraines.com. So that's just barely a little bit I could say about him. He's an incredible guy. He's going to come out here, and he's going to introduce Natalie for you, and we'll get on with the program. So thank you very much.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Oh, good. Now you can hear what was on your TV in 1986. Moonlighting, Law and Order, or ALF. You would turn on the radio, and Stacey's Q's Two of Hearts would be on, or Kenny Loggins' Danger Zone, and the Indigo Girls hadn't even released an album yet. But that year, Shambhala Press published this revolutionary book. Goldberg offers suggestions, encouragement, and solid advice on many aspects of the writing craft. The constant advice is keep your hand moving. And Natalie has had lots of hands moving, selling over 850,000 copies, and it was translated into 14 languages. At the same time, she's here to release her other book, The Great Spring. A book of personal essays drawing her years of writing, teaching, and practicing Zen. Natalie Goldberg shares the experiences that have opened her to new ways of being alive, experiences that point the way forward in our lives and our writing. While Writing Down the Bones offers a bright, inspired practice for writing, The Great Spring presents the unfolding of a life driven by that practice. So please, let's welcome Natalie Goldberg.
Wow. Can you hear me? Can everyone hear me? Okay. The lights are bright. It's so nice to be here. I'm not often in LA, but the quality of light here is tremendous. And at first, I don't know if you know, I paint, and I thought, oh, it's like Aix-en-Provence. And then I thought, no, it's like LA. But it's fabulous. So if you're in a traffic jam or anything, just enjoy the light, really. And the trees. So I'm going to read a short piece from The Great Spring, which is my new book. And it's 22 essays. And it really fits in with writing down the bones. Somehow they're connected. Sort of, I told you what to do with writing down the bones. And now I'm showing you what I have done all these years. I promised you that I would keep going. So I have. This is my 14th book. And also, I wrote this in 2014 while I had cancer. I'm okay now, but I wanted, in case I didn't make it out, and at that point it looked like I might not, I wanted to record some things I remembered and some things I wanted to share before I went out. And I want to point this out. How many of you are writers? Okay. How many of you are poets? How many of you are Zen practitioners? A few? Okay. What else? What are the rest of you? But I wanted to say that when you keep practicing, even when you're with cancer, you can keep going. It's just part of your life. You don't stop brushing your teeth, which is a practice you do every day. And when you have cancer, usually you do brush your teeth. So I write, too. It becomes a practice. So I'm going to read you one about tennis, because I bet you didn't know at one point I was a good athlete. Okay. And I also want to thank everybody who organized this. I know it took a lot of work, and I really appreciate everyone who put time in. Tennis, for Baxime Goddard. When I cannot sleep, I relate the old story in my head. Tennis, my first taste of no mind, living on the edge of instinct. I include Jane Makowski, who did not play tennis, but beat me every summer in the freestyle swim. I was repeatedly second. I accepted this and went to the courts. Jane from Queens, short, dark-skinned, white smile, curly brown hair, with a bracelet on your left wrist. Where are you now? If you hadn't beat me, I wouldn't remember you. It is 3 a.m. in a hotel in the Dordogne Valley, where at 5 p.m. the evening before, against all reason, and instead of dinner, I had ordered a glacé liégeois avec glacé café. The French, when they make coffee ice cream, are serious. The rich, tawny dessert is full of caffeine. I had cursed myself to another sleepless night. Mostly, I can't get over the feel in my hand of the dark tape wound around and the heft of the handle, how the grip went down and rooted to my very feet through the soles of my sneakers. At 12, I went to summer camp and walked on a court for the first time. All first times after that didn't matter. I held the racket at an old-fashioned angle, straight arm, muscle bulge hardening below my unbent elbow, open swing, chest undone, step into it, step back away, come to me, come away, unfurl the white spalding ball, thumb and forefingers, steady wrist, my age a dozen years. Camp Algonquin, the only camp I ever went to, my wood Slasinger bought for $25 at the hardware store on Hempstead Turnpike, so long ago, so young. I loved tennis with every cell. And the amazing thing was, I couldn't do it alone. I had to have a partner. I tried the squash walls. The ball answered wrong. Came back too fast, too low, too artificial, too alone. I needed others before I knew or could pronounce loneliness. Alone on the court, I'd play with anyone who arrived. Bunk 6, the 9-year-olds. The waiters at 16, it didn't matter. Just play with me. Hit the ball and I'll hit it back. High fly, low slam, curve, slice, skidding, pop, pouring the life out of me. Did I play with Melvin Greenspan or Freddie Kornbluth or Irwin Berger at camp? I don't think so. I kissed them through my 13th and 14 years. Irwin with the long straight nose and red freckles covering his whole body. Freddie, who is probably in jail now. And Melvin in the gambling racket. But Irwin, I bet, is a dentist like his uncle Ira. In the middle of the night, I remember how I visited my grandmother in Miami Beach in December and walked away from the ocean 4 blocks to where a tournament was being held at Flamingo Park, sat on a green bench between the high iron fences separating the 8 courts. I closed my eyes, feeling the pa, pa, pa around me in all 4 directions from the felted yellow balls hitting in the magnificent center of the strings. I could tell from the sound who could play and who was faking it, who drank too much, who had wrong sex the night before, and whose wife didn't love him. It was all men playing that afternoon, and soon my grandmother would be looking to serve me her boiled plain chicken. To return to family, I tore myself away from the hum in my body, the central hunger in my breath. At home, I grew wan in front of the television, too easy to use the word depression. I was disappearing. At home, I didn't care about winning. I gave that up at birth, out of my mother's belly in 1948. At home, I surrendered to sadness. My mother shopping at Lohmann's to ameliorate whispers of Auschwitz. My father split open with rage by the taste and excitement of war. And my grandparents with their immigrant dream of American success. But come each green of July and August at Summit Lake in the Adirondacks, electricity bolted through my right hand, all the way down my legs. Against Camp Ticonderoga, Camp Iroquois, all the little white savages from the suburbs, I could beat them all. Whoever invented tennis, thank you. Who put this aspirin on my tongue? Uncle Venti, who went into partnership with Bob Scher, and a woman from Canada who insisted on Shabbat, taught us the McGill marching song that I can still whisper some nights when all else fails. The G stands for grace and gallantry, sons and daughters of the world to be. My relative owned Camp Algonquin, the only reason I could go. I found an opening there, not to fame and fortune, but to a clarity outside the weight of history and my mother's aggravation. The only thing playing on the field of thought was the swing, the lob, the eye narrowed on the net, the follow through, the bounce, the splash on the other side. Far away, the other campers were playing volleyball, softball. I wore my navy blue shorts and white t-shirt. I did not play at home ever until my junior year of high school, when I was dying inside. After dragging myself through the unforgiving halls of 9th and 10th grades and into the spring of my junior year, I finally tried out for 3rd singles. The short gym teacher, Miss, I thought I'd never forget her name. Late in the season, she turned in the green seat of the school bus, headed for another game. And you, Natalie, have never missed a practice. How could I? I had nothing else to do. I'd never go to the junior prom, never have a boyfriend, only two friends, Phyllis DiGiovanni, whose father was a garbage man, and Denise Hodges, whose mother cracked her gum while frying hamburgers over the stove. I'd come home from games late, everyone at the table eating. I stood at the entrance of the kitchen, green linoleum spread out like an ocean between us. My father paused for a moment, a pickle in his right hand, noticing for the first time that I wasn't there. Where were you? Tennis. Head nod, eat, and I joined the onrush of food. But when Miss What's-Her-Name had turned in the seat of that bus, even more important than tennis, she recognized me. Someone else considered me. The lost girl had a place. She held her own on the court. I had played Massapequa that afternoon. I won the first match 6-love, and the second 6-1. Going home, flushed with victory in the last seat on the bus, I sat quietly, looking out the window, seeing my reflection in glass. 2 days later, Farmingdale High played Beth Page. The girl across the court, with two long braided pigtails and a cracked front tooth, could not return my serve, which seemed as sharp as a broken mirror. Even I was surprised by its speed. My opponent never had a chance. This time, I sat behind the gym teacher in the bus going home and noticed the part in my teacher's black hair and how the strands dangled above her shoulders. How did I dare leave tennis behind, drop that true poetry for the one of words? What other things have I left? Minnesota, Ann Arbor, college, graduate school, two literary agents, a dozen houses and apartments, sex with men, though that too was a fine thing, believing Norfolk, Nebraska was the center of America. Not so many years from now, I'll leave the body behind, hover unencumbered the way I did in puberty. Only then I had a fine body to re-enter when I put the racket in its wood frame, twisted the screws tight so it wouldn't warp, tucked the two balls into my back pocket, and walked off the court into the scream of summer. And because it is the 30th anniversary of Bones, I thought I would read one short chapter. And I want to send this out to the two Stevens, the poet Stephen and the person from Shambhala, the publisher Stephen. Okay. Writers have good figures. I picked this one particularly because I asked someone about LA, does everyone here work out? You know, because that's the image I have. Writers have good figures. What people don't realize is that writing is physical. It doesn't have to do with thought alone. It has to do with sight, smell, taste, feeling, with everything being alive and activated. The rule for writing practice of keeping your hand moving, not stopping, actually is a way to physically break through your mental resistances and cut through the concept that writing is just about ideas and thinking. You are physically engaged with the pen, and your hand connected to your arm is pouring out the record of your senses. There is no separation between the mind and body. Therefore, you can break through the mind barriers to writing through the physical act of writing, just as you can believe with your mind that your hand won't stop at the wood so you can break a board in karate. After one writing class, a student in amazement said, "Oh, I get it. Writing is a visual art." Yes, and it's kinesthetic, visceral art too. I've told fourth graders that my writing hand could knock out Muhammad Ali. They believe me because they knew it was true. When I look around at people writing, I can tell just by their physical posture if they have broken through or not. If they did, their teeth are rattling around in their mouth, no longer tight in their gums. Their hearts might be pounding hard or aching. They are breathing deeply. Their handwriting is looser, more generous, and their bodies are relaxed enough to run for miles. This is why I say all writers, no matter how fat, thin, or flabby, have good figures. They are always working out. Remember this. They are in tune, toned up, in rhythm with the hills, the highway, and can go for long stretches and many miles of paper. And what great writers actually pass on is not so much their words, but they hand on their breath at their moments of inspiration. If you read a great poem aloud, for example, To a Skylark by Percy Bysshe Shelley, and read it the way he set it up and punctuated it, what you are doing is breathing his inspired breath at the moment he wrote that poem. That breath was so powerful, it still can be awakened in us over 150 years later. Taking it on is very exhilarating. This is why it is good to remember, if you want to get high, don't drink whiskey. Read Shakespeare, Tennyson, Keats, Hopkins, Millay aloud, and let your body sing.
Well, thank you very much for joining us in West Hollywood.
Yeah,
and when this event was announced, I heard from a lot of people who are fans of yours, and it's clear that they feel as if you're close friends. You know, it seems like most of your readers feel as if you're one of their best friends almost. And what is it about your writing? Yeah.
Not personally, though. Go ahead.
Yeah. What is it about your writing that causes these feelings of closeness?
Well, I'm personal, but people are more personal than me. Maybe I'm telling you some deep truth. And this is probably it. I'm meeting you under discursive thinking. You know, under yada, 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 to some deep place in your heart. Because really, this book, my books are, especially Bones, is backed by 2,000 years of watching the mind, you know, in Zen practice. So it's not from here. I think that's it. I'm meeting you from a deep place.
And you've had readers go to great lengths. There was a reader who, after reading Banana Rose, traveled to...
Yes. Do you want...
No, I was...
Okay. When Banana Rose, my novel, came out, it was out, I don't remember how long, 9 months, and I stopped in a cafe. It was a Sunday, and I stopped to get something, and someone came up to me and said, "Are you Natalie Goldberg?" And I said, "Yes." She said, "I just finished reading Banana Rose, and I live in Virginia, and I have a job there. I had to come to Taos to see it, Taos, New Mexico. I left work on Friday. I drove across the country. I've been here for a short while. I took tomorrow off to drive back through the night." And it was so unbelievable that I didn't even make a big deal. I said, "Oh, that's nice." until she left. I thought I should have given her a sandwich. You know, I just like, wait, I don't know who she is now. And yeah, it's been, there's story like that after story. Yeah, it's been remarkable.
And you talked about, even in the piece that you just shared, about loneliness, and even, I think, in The Great Spring, you talk about that your greatest fear is loneliness. And so does publication make a dent in that loneliness?
No. No, it... It sharpens the experience, because you get to know me, and there are too many of you, so I can't, you know, people come at me, and part of me thinks, oh, they like me, but it's really the book and, you know, the writer. I'm not the writer. I mean, I am. I'm the one who writes the books, but that's different than everyday Natalie. You know, that's moment by moment life. Yeah, it's really different. Yeah.
And could you describe what writing practice is?
Oh, one more time. Okay. You know, I've taught for all these years, really taught for 40 years. Get your pen, fast writing pen, because you don't want a pen that's slow, like a ballpoint, because the mind is much faster than the pen. The mind is much faster than the pen anyway. And you keep your hand going. Go, 10 minutes, I remember. Every time you get stuck, come back to I remember and keep going. You keep moving. And what that does, it breaks through discursive thinking and through monkey mind. That voice in you that's commenting while you're writing, but your writing is being connected to your body, or this way, and monkey mind is saying, I hate you, you're stupid, why are you writing, yada, 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 but you're physically doing it and hearing, you know, going. When you're done writing, there's a gap between what you think you wrote, because you're listening to monkey mind, and what you really wrote. And then what the idea is to read it aloud to someone with no comment. And that closes the gap between who you think you are and who you are. Not good or bad, no good or bad, you just practice. That's the important thing, it's a practice, like tennis, like anything. And yeah, that's basically it. But it's so powerful that I'm willing to keep repeating it. I am a little nervous that I won't be allowed to die. I'm afraid I'll come at 110. Okay, get out your pens. I want to say one more thing.
Sure.
That I know everyone uses computers now, but it's a different physical activity, and a slightly different part of the mind comes out. And I like that even if you drive, you still have to know how to walk. And handwriting, that I handwrite everything. And it's a different physical activity. And really, cursive is so important, and it's very upsetting that people are not learning cursive, young people, because it actually is a developmental step in growing up. And that's why people can read your handwriting and tell about your character. It's really important.
It seems a practice that lends itself to prose. So do your poems come out of writing practice as well?
I developed writing practice as a poet. If I'm hot on a 10-minute write, what I would do is fill a notebook and then later on reread the whole notebook. And sometimes there'll be a hole I'm on and I typed it up as a poem. Or sometimes I would get a short poem. Top of my lungs has a lot of those. Maybe I'll read you one.
Sure.
Top of My Lungs came out in 2003. There's one short one that I was very pleased. I found it in my notebook. So I'll pull it out and type it as a poem. And then sometimes my whole notebook is just shit. You know, there's nothing good in it. And so then what I do, I might find one line And one of the lines was, I came to love my life. I remember that. And I would start a lot of writing practices with that till I finally really hit home with it. But I'm going to read you the short one called I'm Trying. I'm trying to tell something about empty farm fields broken by fall and the half-light of sun, cafes in towns with only a gas station, church, and bar. I'm trying to say something about loneliness, about the crack of pale yellow corn stalks in the middle of September in Minnesota.
Yes, thank you.
I like when you can just find them in your notebook. Then they're not so self-conscious. It's about, it's empty of you. That's the other thing. You eventually want writing to do writing, and you're out of the way.
You say eventually, and in Writing Down the Bones, you state that sometimes you have notebooks filled with terrible self-pitying stuff for pages.
Yes.
Does that lessen over time, or do you find yourself...
Yeah, actually, it does, because you have to reread your notebooks, and it's so boring. And so you see it, and so what I do now when I start complaining, I love to complain. I start to complain, I put dash, what I really want to say is, and I drop to a deeper level, or I try to.
And you state writing practice is not therapy.
No. Writing practice is an opportunity to meet your mind. And I think I said someplace, even today, maybe with you, not well-being, but the ground of being. Awake mind, you know, I've studied Zen for a long time, but where is enlightenment and awake mind in the West? It's in literature. It reflects back human life, which is different than therapy. Therapy's not bad, but it's different.
You dedicated Wild Mind to your therapist, or was in the thanks section, right? Is
maybe
that correct? Yes, in the thanks section.
Time again. Yeah. Acknowledgements, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so are there certain topics that you believe are worthy of, or that are just for therapy and not writing? Or certain vernacular?
You know, well, you know what it is? Private. You can write private, but when you read, you don't make that public. And the reason you know is personal is okay for writing. Private is like, you know, you feel uncomfortable when someone reads it. And so there's a difference. So if it's private, you have to digest it so it's you can claim it and it's personal. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And in The Great Spring, you tell this little anecdote about an aging Broadway star that you talk with.
Yeah. Oh, people in California would like that.
Yeah. Would you want to share?
Star. You know who it was? It was, you know.
You didn't give names.
Who played Jane in Tarzan a long time ago. No. Bexim. You know who. No, who does the athletic stuff and... Jane Fonda. It was Jane Fonda, yeah.
And she said, what was her response when you said you...
I went to the... She was wonderful. She studied for a while at Zen Center in Santa Fe. And I told her that I'd seen her Broadway show. It was just a one-woman Broadway show. And she said, you liked it? She said, why didn't you come back stage? I said, I didn't know, you know, you go to Broadway, it's, you know, big time. She said, why didn't you come back stage? I said, I didn't know I could come back. She said, you really liked it? Did you really like it? And it was so touching that, you know, she's been around for so long and yet not insecure, but, you know, we all have that edge of insecurity. And it was very sweet. It was really sweet. And she did a beautiful job on stage. But it's so naked. You never get tough.
And in that piece, you mentioned that success is different from love.
Yeah.
And it seems like artists sometimes will get that confused. And what is it about being in the arts that causes that confusion?
Well, I can only talk for myself. But I know a lot of writers were never heard as kids. No one talked to them, were never listened to. So you think, I'm gonna pour out my real heart, my parents are gonna read it, and they're gonna love me. But meanwhile, your parents don't even read books and couldn't care less. You know? And it seems anyone you really want to read your book never does. Could I tell this?
Sure.
Okay, it's Alan, I read here in 1990 with Allen Ginsberg. And we taught for a weekend in LA in 1990, and then we gave a big reading. There must have been 700 people. And my sister lived in LA at the time, and I invited her. And she didn't come, she was late. So I held up the whole reading. And then she finally came, and she had a lot of bags and stuff, and moved people over and sat down. And then I said, Alan, we could read. And then at the end, you know, thinking, I went right to her, and I said, well, what'd you think? She said, I want to talk to him, Alan Ginsberg. So I want to talk to him. He reminds me of my friend Kenny. And then she said, is he gay? I said, yes, he's gay. So that, I'm giving you an example of like... Don't write to get love. But you can feel love as you write. It often opens. Even when you're writing about racism, sexism, you know, war, because you're speaking. You know, you're coming close to yourself.
Your book on craft, Thunder and Lightning, you state, I've not seen writing lead to happiness in my friends' lives. Yeah. That's how you started the book off. I'm just letting you know.
Sorry.
So what does writing lead to?
Oh, that's a wonderful question. Writing can lead to wholeness, to you meeting yourself and embracing yourself. Let me see. I think that's the deepest thing. And realizing that you're alive on the earth and not forever.
Yeah. And if happiness is not found in writing itself, where is it found?
I was afraid you were going to... In eating slowly a chocolate chip cookie.
And I want to talk about your poetry. So you wrote your first poem at age
24.
And do you remember the topic?
Yeah, it was about a chocolate cake. It was, I don't know if any of you know Ebinger's in Brooklyn. See, Ebinger's is like it. And it was a bakery, and they had a blackout cake. And like nothing on earth, all the can't touch it. And I wrote my first true poem where I really trusted myself and didn't look out, you know, is this good, about the Ebinger's blackout cake. Yeah.
And you describe koans as cutting through conditional ways of thinking. And I wondered if poetry also offers that to you.
Do you know what koans are? Like, what's the sound of one hand clapping? Or quickly, quickly, with no thought, what's your original face before your parents were born? There's no answer. There's no logical answer. Koans, poetry's pretty good, but koans cut your throat. I have to say.
There's something better than poetry? All right.
Not better. You can cut your throat and then you can write a poem.
And in Bones, you mention that your next poetry collection is going to be Top of My Lungs. And that was true, but it came out in 2002, which was 16 years after Bones.
Funny you notice that. What happened was I won a fellowship, a Bush Foundation fellowship in Minnesota. They give you so much money there for because they want to keep you because it's so cold. Nobody would stay there otherwise. So I won a Bush Foundation fellowship, and for a year I just could write. And I finished this manuscript top of my lungs, and I couldn't get anyone to publish it. So I thought, well, fuck, what should I do now? And someone said, why don't you write that book you were talking about 6 years ago? I said, you mean Writing Down the Bones? And she said, yeah. I said, okay. And I wrote it. And so the manuscript just sat. And then my agent thought of the idea of putting the poems with paintings. And then somebody wanted it. I paint, too. And people became interested. Yeah.
And you discovered painting about the same time of writing.
I, like, spontaneous combustion. At 1974 in Taos, New Mexico, I started meditating, writing, and painting. Yeah.
And so, being the 30th anniversary of Writing Down the Bones, what was it like to revisit the text for this anniversary edition?
Well, you know, that little pipsqueak wrote a good book, and it's annoying, you know, because I'm 68 now, and I'm always competing with her. You know, she broke without knowing at a paradigm, and I'm always wanting to break. I just say, one more, just one more. But you can't do it by being aware of it. I knew nothing when I wrote that. I had just come out of incredibly strict Zen practice, nonstop.
Did you update any references in the edition?
No, that's a great question, because, you know, you can tell I still came out of English Lit, because I quote Shelley, which I probably wouldn't do now, and I didn't make sure as much to have people of color and a lot of women, whereas I would now. But it's kind of sweet when I read it. You can tell that I majored in English Lit, and I had the Norton Anthology, you know.
And you have an entire chapter on obsessions and writers' obsessions. What are you currently obsessed with?
Oh. Well, I just finished a manuscript on having cancer. Do you want to hear the title? It took me a long time. Down to the Marrow, Facing Death in America. Not bad. But I'm going to move into another book about Busan and Basho, the two great Japanese haiku writers. So I'm moving into that as my obsession, yeah.
And then you also mentioned, it could have been Long Quiet Highway, that you can listen to a song repeatedly for about 50 times.
750 times. Bob Dylan. Does anyone know Bob Dylan? I'd give you my teeth to meet him. Yeah.
And so that's currently the songs you play on repeat, Dylan?
Over and over still, you know, I'm very faithful. I drove from Minneapolis to Taos and listened to one song, trying to get to heaven before they closed the door on Time Out of Mind. That was in the mid-90s, I think.
The Great Spring is a beautiful book, and you open sections with poems. How did you come across that structure?
Oh, yeah. Well, I always like to stick in a poem now, once in a while, a poem. So I thought, well, I'll stick these in. But they actually fit in. They're short, and they kind of meet what's happening. I'll read one. You want to hear one?
Yeah.
Okay. Which one? Okay, I'll read you the first one. And it's the section on searching. Often I ask, was it worth it to dedicate yourself so completely? The answer, no. Then I remember. I saw inside the night sky. So they're very, I love short poems now, and I think they're hard to write. Yeah.
And in Bones, you give the advice to go further than you think you can. And so what in the Great Spring was further than you thought?
Oh, I think everything in that book was further. I really worked it, yeah. Like the tennis, I tried to get every angle I could think of about tennis for me.
Could you describe the title, how you came about the title of The Great Spring?
The Great Spring, I wrote an essay called The Great Spring years ago, and I wrote a book called The Great Failure that came out in 2004. And I always wanted to write a book about the Great Spring, because of course spring is great, but that in Zen, enlightenment is referred to as the Great Spring, when everything melts and you crack open, you know? So it had, I like a title that has many layers of meaning. I'm very satisfied with that title. Yeah.
And a lot of your books, there's audio versions. Will there be one of The Great Spring?
I just finished it.
You did?
Yeah,
all
I just finished it at home like 2 days ago. And it'll probably be on Audible, I think. You know, and I think you can get it on Amazon in maybe 2 or 3 weeks. Yeah.
Yeah, there are sections in when hearing you read The Great Failure, when talking about your father, you just seem delighted to retell the stories.
Yes.
And it's so apparent to the listener.
Oh, great.
So I look forward to hearing that. And so I want to talk about your coming out in Wild Mind, and if you could tell that story.
Okay. I guess it's not known that much, but I've been with women for a long time. And I've actually written about it, but no one... I had breakfast... By the way, he's terrific. You're lucky you have him.
Thank you.
But I had breakfast with him, and he brought that up, that in Wild Mind, I write about how I started to go be with women. And I said, and it came out... That was in Wild Mind, 1990, and my mouth fell open. I said, you were the first person ever to mention it. And I thought it was great stories. No one ever mentioned it. But what happened was I was intensely writing down the bones on my Smith Corona typewriter. And finally, the last 7 weeks, I said, Natalie, you just have to do it. I don't care. And so I just, I didn't even think. I pulled out one page, another page, and I was in total deep concentration for 7 weeks. And I mean, it took me longer to write it, but I was pushing at the end. And I wasn't thinking, I was in a much deeper place. And finally, I pulled out a sheet and I went, I think you're done with the book. And the next thing that shot through me from a very deep place was, and I want to be with women now. And it really scared me because I was a feminist, but I really didn't know very many lesbians at the time. And I thought of them as like driving semis and being dykes. So I got really scared, and I ignored it, but it was strong. When something comes from a deep place, you can't get rid of it. And so several months later, I went to Europe, and I went, I stopped at a friend's apartment in New York City, and I woke up in the middle of the night, and I was looking over the Hudson. She was near the Hudson, and I said, okay, Nat, what do you want? And I said, come on, let me just try to see what it's like. So I went the next day and I bought The Gay Guide to Europe. And my friend Carol, who's straight, during the day, this was in 86. We would go, like the first place we went was Spain, Madrid. So we'd look up a lesbian bar. And at that time, they started at 11 o'clock and they had no signs and you could get in trouble. So we found how to get there. We found it during the day. And at night at 11 o'clock, I'd go. And it was very, I'd order a beer. I don't drink, but I ordered a beer and sat at the bar and just looked. My first bar in Madrid, what's his name? Famous actor. You do know him, but I won't remember. Anyway, he was in chains, and I realized it was an S&M bar. I only realized that many years later. And so I went, every place we went, I went to a gay bar, and a lesbian bar. And I was fascinated, and I felt so free, because I was reading Hemingway a lot. And he'd go to bars, and I wanted to go to bars. Even though I didn't drink, I wanted to be able to do what I wanted to do. And writing broke open my mind. So no longer was it divided in half. Hey, you could sleep with women, too. How original. So, you know, it broke me open.
And that was published in 1990. And just to give everyone context, that was 7 years before Ellen came out, which people kind of have this marker of, you know, when it was kind of acceptable. I mean, so that was quite ahead of its time to make that public declaration.
Well, yeah, you know, you develop in writing practice. You know, the writer in me is kick-ass. She'll say anything. She doesn't care. I have to deal with it afterwards. Yeah. But she doesn't pay attention to anything except what she needs to say. But I want to say that I did call my editor at the time. It was Bantam, Tony Burbank, who is a great editor. And I said, you know, I'm writing about sleeping with women. Do you think that's okay? And she said, why, Natalie, lesbians read lots of books.
And
can I say one other thing? I also tell in Wild Mind that my father, I called my parents, and I wanted to tell them. And my father said, my mother said, oh, this is some time to tell us. You know, never would be the right time. And my father said, why are you telling us? And I said, because, you know, I want to be honest and upfront. My father said, you know, I like to be kept in the dark.
And you have several memoirs. One is about your teacher, and then also about your teacher and then your father. So you have these memoirs about the men in your life. And have you thought that you might write?
About the women in my life? I had a very strong relationship with my father. Not always good. He wasn't a great father. But I loved him. There was a lot of power there. And I didn't have much of a relationship with my mother, hardly any. So I did write a whole manuscript about that, but it went out to 16 publishers, and it was during the recession in the late 90s. Yeah, whenever it was. No, it was later than that. 2007, yeah. And the publisher said, we cannot take a chance with this. So it was very raw. I did write it, but it was, maybe it wasn't, I can't go back to it because every time I look at it, I want to vomit. So I don't rework it.
All right. And so I thought we would kind of switch up the format here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show an image, and you can actually see them there as well as behind you. And I just want, like, your impressions or what you, you know, if you have a story or an anecdote about the image I'm going to show you. So,
Should it just be a few words on each
one? Sure, yeah. I mean,
oh, okay.
I'm not counting your words,
okay.
But...
Okay. Ballad of a Sad Cafe, Carson McCullers. That is, we read that in ninth grade. It was the only, have you read Carson McCullers? If you didn't, go get that book. It's only 70 pages, it's a novella. We read it in ninth grade, and I never got over it. And that's why I'm a writer today.
Yeah. And it's a beautiful story in The Great Spring that you talk
Thank
about
you.
That. All right.
Oh my God, Erica Jong. I had a restaurant in the early 70s. I won't go into the whole story, but it was with four partners, and it was a nonprofit restaurant. And I was making ratatouille, chopping onions for a restaurant. You do it for a long time. And at the end of the day, I wandered into Senecor Bookstore in Ann Arbor, and there was a thin volume of poetry called Fruit and Vegetables. And before that, I majored in English Lit, and even though I loved literature, I never thought of writing, because we read Dead Men from England. So I saw Fruits and Vegetables by Erica Jong. I pulled it out, I opened, and the first poem I saw was about sauteing an onion. I thought, you can write about that? And I must have been so ripe. I just felt the synapse close. Did I buy the book? No. I put it back, I walked home, and started writing.
And the next.
Oh, I can't see.
Oh, Dinner and Nightmares?
Oh, Dinners and Nightmares, Diane De Prima. Wow. That's a wonderful book, a good book for writing, too. I was so amazed when I read it. I remember her writing about Oreo cookies. I just loved when it was these ordinary, normal things. So it inspired me as a young writer that I could do it about those kind of things. Yeah. And Book of Nightmares by Galway Kinnell. I couldn't even pronounce his name, but when I had Naked Lunch, the restaurant, every Thursday they had a free poetry reading. And I went to it at the University of Michigan, and I heard Galway Kinnell when Book of Nightmares came out. Sancho Panza, my boy child, it was heaven. I was blown out. It really, you know. There was nothing better on earth.
Spiral notebooks.
Oh, spiral notebooks. I am mad because I started buying them and I only write in 70-page spiral notebooks. I used to get them for like 99 cents. They're $3.69 now. And the corners are sharp rather than soft edges, which is what I like.
And what do you...
I can't believe that.
What do you intend on doing with these notebooks?
I throw them out. After I fill them up and I reread them and I suck out what I need, I throw them out.
Someone gasped over here when you said that. I want to let you know that. All right, so now we're going to move on to people. And this is the first person.
Bob Dylan, you know. I did a film on Bob Dylan with the filmmaker Mary Feit. We went up to Hibbing to figure out what effect Hibbing, Minnesota, had, because he left at 18, and at 21, he was doing some of his best songs. So you knew Hibbing affected him. No one had left Hibbing but Bob Dylan. So everyone was there, his best friend, his English teacher, everyone.
George O'Keefe.
Oh, George O'Keefe. I love New Mexico because not only is it a fabulous place, but a great artist paid attention to it and painted it. Utah is beautiful, but no one, you know, there's no artist that just made the signature there. When you go to Yosemite, Ansel Adams, you know, a visual artist. So you not only meet the beauty of nature, but human consciousness meeting it. Oh, Allen Ginsberg. There's no one like Allen Ginsberg. He's the only writing class I ever took in 1976 at Naropa at the Jack Kerouac School of Disembodied Poetics. And we eventually became friends after Bones came out and we taught together. And he was a great man, a tremendously generous man. And I don't know if you know, when he knew he was dying, you know, he'd sold his all his papers I think, to Stanford and got $1 million. And through the night, before he died that morning, he called all his friends, said goodbye, and asked if they needed money. Yeah. He was a great man. He was a great man. Oh, James L. White. I don't know if you know him. He's a gay poet who I knew in Minnesota. And when he was very sick, Gray Wolf Press accepted his book of poetry. And he cried in the hospital and said, they don't accept gay poetry unless it's really good. And this was in 1983. You know, it was very early, 1981. He also told me, after you give a reading, you have to either eat, drink, fuck, or dance. Because, you know, you're so hyped up.
What are you doing after this reading? What's your plan, Natalie?
None of your business.
And this is Anais Nin.
Oh. What I like about her, she had two husbands at the same time. Did you know that?
Yes.
One on the East Coast, one on the West Coast. And she managed it lovely and wrote books.
Anne Sexton.
I love Anne Sexton. I love her poetry. And, oh, Kate Green, who was a good friend of mine, studied with her at the University of Boston, got her MFA there. And Anne Sexton was so charged up that sometimes she would light one cigarette and then light another one and be smoking two cigarettes.
I thought I looked cute in the photo, so I thought I would just show that. All right,
you're nice. Cute. He has a fabulous title of a book. Give it to me again.
Oh, Your Dead Body is My Welcome Mat.
Is that outrageous? Your Dead Body is My Welcome Mat. Oh, Hemingway. It kills me that he could write so deeply. And his last book, I think, was Old Man in the Sea, which I've taught recently. Go read it again. It's phenomenal. And that there's such a gap between the beauty that he could connect with and then his great suffering. He killed himself, shot himself in the head at 62. Which, by the way, today I saw Genius, the movie about Max Perkins. Please go see it. The great editor.
There's a new slide up.
Oh, Katagiri Roshi. Oh, isn't he beautiful? Oh, he is my great writing teacher. Through Zen, I learned how to write. Oh, Julia Cameron. Where did you get these? I just wrote the 25th anniversary edition introduction for The Artist's Way. And Julia and I lived in Taos, and we now live in Santa Fe, and we're friends.
So now we're moving on to places.
he's working me.
So, well, I can skip a few if that's
no,
all right.
No, it's fun. I can't.
Bread and Chocolate?
Oh, Bread and Chocolate on the corner of, in St. Paul on Grand Avenue. I went there every day for about a year and slowly ate a chocolate chip cookie and made it a meditation. And then finally even stopped, I got tired of the cookie. And just ordered hot water and just sat there and drank hot water and made it a meditation. Where did
booked
you...
Booked up.
Booked up.
Is that the in Archer City?
Oh, that's Larry Archer City, yeah, yeah. Archer City, where Larry McMurtry bought the whole town as it became a ghost town and made the whole thing into bookstores. That's the whole story is in The Great Spring. And I met him and was so nervous because he, in my as an early writer, Last Picture Show and Leaving Cheyenne, he wrote it, you know, at like 21, and it's phenomenal. I was so nervous meeting him as an adult who had lots of books out that I completely blew it. And I write about going there.
And that story was first published in the LA Review of Books.
Yes, yeah, the LA Review. That's a nice magazine. Is anyone here from that? Okay. How do you know all this about me?
It's
Croissant Express. How did you find that? Is it the real one?
I worked for these images, yeah.
You really did, oh my God. Croissant Express is where I conceived the idea of writing down the bones, and I went there a lot. In Minneapolis, they have incredible croissants. And after I got divorced, I went there for 2 years and only ate croissants. Mabel Dodge?
No, the Minnesota Zen Center.
Oh, I'm not, I can't see.
Oh, sorry.
Oh, I should put on, no, my glasses wouldn't help. Minnesota Zen Center, well, you know. I met my life there. I practice there every morning at 5 a.m., no matter what. It would sometimes be 30 below. So Naked Lunch, a statement to the Ann Arbor community. Oh my God.
It's an article about Naked Lunch.
Naked Lunch. I guess with the internet you can find anything. Jesus. Naked Lunch was the restaurant we had in Ann Arbor, and we would quote from William Burroughs in Naked Lunch, "Suddenly you stop and see what's at the end of your fork."
So in this article, there's a photo. Is that a young Natalie Goldberg in that image?
Yeah, it looks
like
it.
That's you with a like a bandana on your head?
Maybe. I can't see. Wait, I'll look here.
Is that you?
Oh, it might be. Yeah. Yes, that's me. I can't believe. No one has ever pulled up this stuff. Thank God.
And then Taos.
Oh, well, Taos is, you know, one of my deep homes. I don't even know what to say about it right now. It's where I woke up. It's where it gave me permission to do everything.
And they have a Natalie Goldberg Day now.
Yeah, at the 30th anniversary, they did a weekend celebration of Natalie Goldberg, of writing down the bones, and the mayor gave me a plaque and declared Natalie Goldberg Day. And I want to say this because it's really interesting. I 13 years ago, I kept teaching at Mabel Dodge and go up there a lot, but I live now in Santa Fe. And that weekend, I turned to someone who was setting the whole thing up, had set it up, took months, and I said, if I still lived here, you wouldn't celebrate this, right? And she said, exactly. You never, in the place you live, forget it. Just like your family. They can't recognize you, but that I moved to Santa Fe, they could recognize me.
And that's the end. Do you like questions? Do you want to do some questions, audience questions? How are you doing? So it seems like we have time for just a few questions. So just raise your hand and a microphone is being passed around. I want to remind everyone that a question, if you saw it on the page, would have a question mark at the end of your statement. All right, thanks. Everyone took the hint? Good.
I'm so glad you said that because I was going to give that speech.
Oh, you know what? Later, they have them for sale, actually. She was asking about the Writing Down the Bones 30th anniversary book, which it's for sale outside. It's a beautiful book with an introduction by Julia Cameron and Even if you have the original, I would strongly suggest getting that edition. It's beautiful. Okay, but what about right after this? Thanks.
Natalie, thank you for being here. You talked about Zen practice cracking you open, and you talked about writing practice allowing you to enter a space within you somehow. Can you talk about the connection between those two practices and Zen practice as a vehicle to writing?
There's no separation. I wrote a book called True Secret. It was my book before the Great Spring. Writing practice and Zen practice are exactly alike. There's no separation. So watch it. If you start doing writing practice, you're backing in to Zen.
Okay, we've
not
got
bad. A... Not bad.
Oh, no. You're just waving to me. Okay. Do we have a question over here?
Something you said I've thought a lot about, and that's about handwriting and how they're not teaching it. In your position, have you thought about trying to like go into Washington and get that made again part of our educational program?
I haven't, no. I would like to because
I know you're very busy.
I was an educator and I had even have my teaching certificate. Instead I carry on about it publicly.
Do we have one in the middle?
There was a...
No? Well, we got one over there. There
you go. So thank you for being here. On that topic, I have terrible handwriting, barely legible even to myself. And I almost never write by hand. And I know you are a proponent of doing that. And I'm just wondering if you can convince me to put down my laptop.
Slow up,
okay.
And make it so it's legible. It's not a race. Mm. And actually that physical act of slowing it up might, you might rest at a deeper place. And I'm not saying that typing isn't okay. Another thing I want to say, if you use a computer at work, it's really nice when you do this kind of writing to go to a cafe and do handwriting so it switches the mind and it signals we're doing something different. So you don't feel like you're always at work.
We have time for maybe one more question.
One more? Okay. And then there will be book sales outside, so if we can let them come up front so Natalie can sign, and there's also some little treats that we'll bring out.
The one more question is, can you describe the difference between writing practice and writing?
There's no difference.
Okay.
There's no difference. I don't know anything else. I write all my books that way.
I think we'll take one more because there's a really, really young person who wants to ask a question. Oh, wait, hold on.
It's actually like very similar to what he just asked, but like when you go down or when you go to write like an essay or your novel or something, do you structure it out beforehand? Like this is what's going to happen at the
end? No, I don't. But I want to say, did you hear what she said? Okay. I wrote a book called Thunder and Lightning, which addresses this. People ask me all the time. But for instance, with The Great Spring, I went through a period of like 10 years where I was reading the New Yorker magazine a lot, all those long essays. So that long essay form got in my body. So when I started writing, it seemed like I went longer. I breathed deeper. So in other words, what you do is you learn, like poetry. I'm not writing poetry now. I'd have to learn that form again. What I mean by learn it is read a lot of poetry, try to practice it, so that form is in my body. And then when I do writing practice, it would come out that way. Does that help? Structure is so important. If you have a good structure, you can just fill the structure with your mind, like building a house. If you want to write a book about something, think about the structure. Study the structure of books that you love, because you're when you're reading a book, you're studying the author's mind. Those are your teachers. Okay?
So I know there's probably other people who want to ask questions, but we want to make sure there's time for book sales and signing. So I know folks probably want to chat with Natalie, but we're going to try to get her up front so we have some time for that. And I want to thank everybody for being here, and please come join us at other events.